couples. I worked for the YMCA for a couple of years, so it's well known and loved. I was remembering actually, I was praying for the teams we started. I worked with Richard Lake on a couple of youth work projects where we often did residentials together and stuff. So it's great to be with you. We're going to hear about Psalm 1 this morning. So I'm going to read from Psalm 1 and then we are going to explore what it means to live a blessed life, how to be blessed from Psalm 1. So let's read together. Psalm 1, blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither, whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. Let's explore what those words might mean together. As we explore this word blessed, thinking about being blessed, what it means to live a blessed life this morning. We've got these words from Psalm 1, that might come up in just a second. But the word opens with blessed is the one. I wonder where that word takes you. If you think of blessed, what does it mean to be blessed? It might mean you just sneeze and someone's like, bless you. I love doing that to strangers. It entirely flows with them. They're doing supermarkets all the time, and my cold sound. But it's not that way. Or maybe you say blessed if you see something really cute, like a puppy. Think, oh, blessed, it's a little puppy. Or maybe you're telling someone off. Say, put that blessed phone away. I'm sure that would be a conversation in any of your households, but maybe. It's a nice way to sign off an email. Every blessing, or you know, any blessing that you know. And maybe you're particularly unfortunate and you think of Brian blessing. I wasn't going to mention impersonation, but I was told we'd be recording this morning, so we're not going to do that. But yeah, I don't know, maybe some people say they've been very blessed. You know, people say, oh, we're very blessed. If they are materially quite wealthy, say, oh, we've been very blessed. But sense that maybe if someone's blessed material wealthy, they're not as blessed. There's something there, maybe, I don't know. Or maybe it's something we pray over. Like we have a marriage service or we pray a blessing in marriage. The thing is, we use this word so many times in so many different ways. I wonder if it can be quite hard to keep track of all the different meanings that we have for this word blessed. See, blessed is a noun and it's a verb. It's a description and it's an action. It's something about being happy, about being fortunate. It's about life going well, knowing a sense of worth and contentment and fulfillment. Like when Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven, or blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. But it's also an action. It's not just a description, it's an action as well. It's something that God does to people, and it's something he asks us to do to one another. Blessing is something that God adds, something that causes the poor in spirit, or the mourners, or the meek, to feel delight, to feel joy, to feel happy, even if circumstances shouldn't possibly permit them. It's a change, it's a difference, it's something that God adds in. And he partners with people and asks them to do the same. Like what he says to Moses in number 6. Tell Aaron this is how to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Say this and I will bless them. So it's a description of a blessing, but it is also a blessing happening in real time. And we as the priesthood of all believers share in that responsibility to bless others. With the sense that as these words are spoken, as we speak blessing, something actually changes. Which makes sense when we think of God speaking and saying, let there be light. And there was. So when God says, let there be blessing, sure enough, blessing will follow. But this psalm captures and instructs us and all the readers as to how we might grow in the blessing that God has for us. My sense is that it all starts with a choice. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but who does delight in the law of the Lord. There's something here about what we choose to engage with and what we choose to not engage with. Choosing not to engage with the wicked and choosing to engage with God's law. We'll know God's blessing if we do not keep in step with the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the company of mockers. And those who like to comment on these things have noticed a progression here. That it's one thing to walk in the same direction as a wicked person, it's quite another to stand and chat and pass the time, and it's quite another still to pull up a chair and to make yourself at home. To sit and chat is even more familiar. To make yourself at home in the company of mockers is to become one of them. And maybe there's something here that feels quite unhelpful as well, like this really a binary analysis of people, like you're a good person or a bad person, a wicked person or a righteous person. And we know that it doesn't necessarily work so much like that. Rather, the way we see people out, we recognise there is goodness in everyone. We don't want to write anyone off as wicked. But the truth is, some company will bring out and nurture the worst in us. Some companies will cause us to lower our expectation of ourselves, will normalise things in us that really shouldn't be normal, things that aren't okay. We've all got bits of ourselves that it's best not to nurture, whether that's hate, or bitterness, or greed, or lust, or power craving. We've all got that stuff in us, and we're doing our best to leave it behind as we become a new creation in God. But the Psalms is saying, think about it. Choose your friends, choose your company wisely. Choose your friends wisely because you tend to become like them. Some people bring out the best in us, others can normalize the worst. Some of our friends can inspire us to greater faith, greater love, to encourage and challenge us in the best way possible. Others will seek to shame us, snare us, condemn us, accuse us, cause us to settle for less. Our choice of company can limit our experience of God's blessing. So I want you to think about it. Think about the people that you have in your life, the people that you surround yourself with and are surrounded by. Now you have a choice here. This isn't about who you serve. We are to serve everyone. But whose opinions do you listen to? Who do you choose to spend time with? Who do you let in to your headspace? We can't always choose who we're co-locating with, but we can choose who we walk with, who we stand with, and who we sit with. We can choose who we listen to and who we give headspace to. And if you're coming up against someone who is suffocating you, or bringing out the worst in you, then in order to protect, to choose, to inherit the blessing that God has for you in your life, you need to reduce your exposure to that person. You don't need to necessarily tell them, just make them smaller in your mind. Put in a little bit of distance. That said, this isn't just about good people and bad people. It's not like being a good person is enough in the eyes of the gospel. There is more to be done here. It's not about trying to decide who a bad person is and just avoiding them. Knowing that even good people have bad days. A good person on a bad day might still be the company of scoffers and mockers. There's something within us here which we don't choose not to nurture. It's quite easy to be befriended, put up a chair and have a little bit of gossip about someone. You know, the conversation gets around to complaining, but it might be that actually we are part of the company of the mockers. If you hear gossiping, if you hear mocking, don't put up a chair. not a part of blessing. We can choose to opt out. But blessing is about more than avoiding bad company. Good company alone isn't enough to bring us to know God's blessing. So we get to verse 2. Blessed is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord, who meditates on that law day and night, day and night. Not blessed is the one with awesome friends. It's not blessed are you when you are financially secure. Blessed are you when you've got fabulous kids. I'm sure you will. It's not that blessed is the one who has got their whole life sorted. But the one who is really blessed, the one who is living with God's enduring favour, who knows peace and contentment and fulfilment, as the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord. So it's worth getting into the mind of the author here who wrote Psalm 1. Because law means something a bit different to us than that which it did to them. We think of this from the psalmist's perspective. They were living in a time when they knew there was one true God. But lots of different cultures and lots of different nations had different perspectives on how we should go about worshipping that one true God. There was lots of different descriptions and ideas about what that God wanted, what that God meant, what he required from us. There was real confusion as people were saying, what is good? What is best? What is right? What does God actually want? These people are saying one thing, these people are saying something else. These people over here saying to throw my son in the fire. Those people say I need to go and make up a potion. These people say I need to climb a mountain. God, what do you want from me? And that sense of uncertainty can erode our well-being. It's like being, you know that confused, is it confused.com advert? They're just playing noise all the time and saying, throw all rubbish, just to, you know, go and use these people for your garbage ones. God, in the same way, God speaks through the melee. That word of God arrives for this psalmist as a description of what is good is offered. As God says, here, O man, what is required of you? Here are some tablets of stone. Here's a covenant. Here's an agreement. A description of how we are to live with God. God brings clarity. He brings definition. He brings purpose to human life. And within that is that sense of blessing and peace and thinking, finally, I know what to do. I know how to be. I know what's going to keep me in a healthy relationship with God. But we still have that law. We'll find it in our Old Testament that it serves as an enduring record of God's character, of his nature and his values. We have the priests and the prophets who have given us an explanation of what that law means, revealing to us who God is and what he's like. But we also know we're not under that law. We're not obliged to obey in the same way that the psalmist was. We're not bound by the law. Because as the author to Hebrews says, it's in Hebrews chapter 1. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets and many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he also made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. So that now, if we want to delight in the law of the Lord, if we want to know the spoken word of God, then we delight in his Son. Jesus is the full revelation of the law of God. Jesus is the new covenant. He is. His body is the blood. And his body is that new covenant. And we want to know and live the blessing of God. And we're to nurture our relationship with Jesus, who is the fulfillment of all the law and all the prophets. And we can meditate on him, as the psalmist says. We can meditate on him day and night, putting ourselves willfully in his presence. Remembering that he's always in the room with us. But whatever is happening, we are with Jesus. We are co-located with him. And when we willfully put ourselves in his presence, when we remember that the place we're standing is holy ground, because God is here, the peace, the joy, the blessing of God's fellowship rests on us. We can meditate on him We can dwell on him, we can reflect on him, we can look to him for revelation and learning and teaching and direction all day and all night. And we will know the blessing of God when we do. We will know fulfillment and contentment and peace and joy. We know that if we want to experience the presence of God now, if we want to feel that blessing, then we do so by His Spirit. That His Spirit is within us and outside of us. So again, the company we keep is really important. Where two or three are gathered, we know that He's there in the midst of us. He's there filling the space in between us as we gather in His name, reaching into us from the outside. As we stay with prayer tables, as we have study groups, as we gather church services like this. But He's also within us, that as we fix our attention on Him, as we pray, as we read, as we speak and act in His name, His share of our head and our heart grows from the inside out. He's on the outside in and the inside out. So that the invitation to us, if we want to live and know this life of blessing, is to walk in step with the Holy Spirit, to choose our company and to choose the Holy Spirit. Our next slide has got the verse from Galatians chapter 5. Which describes something the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace, forbearance and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. Again, those things, there is no law, because we're not under the law anymore. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. We're going to keep in step with anyone. We're going to walk with anyone. Let's walk with the Holy Spirit. It's not about keeping the law, it's about keeping up with the Spirit. Understanding that if we do, that as we keep company with the Holy Spirit, He will shape our lives. He will add His ingredients. He will add love and joy and peace and patience. As sure as an apple tree produces apples, so those things will grow in us. As we keep company with the Holy Spirit. These descriptions, these words, serve as a beautiful picture of the blessed life, of seeing what blessing does in us and through us. But as we receive what God has done for us, as we receive the gift of the Spirit through His Son, we will become more and more blessed. We will know more of the love and the joy and the peace and the patience. And we will be a blessing to others. That this stuff is such good news, we can't keep it to ourselves. We know there's a whole thirsty town around us. There's thirsty people that we work with who are desperate for some of this real fruit. There is a world that is starving for our lack of love and joy and peace and patience. As those who walk with the Spirit, we are sent to walk. To walk alongside those who need to know these blessings, who need to be fed by this real food of the body and blood of Jesus. But this fruit, this blessing is here for us and for others. And the joy of our life, the joy of our situation is that nothing and no one can stop it. But if this is the word of God to us, then no one has the authority to undo this blessing. Like a tree planted by streams of water, yielding its fruit in season, its leaf does not wither and perish. Like a tree planted by streams of water, it doesn't matter what's going on in the big wide world. In that sense, the weather's not going to affect it. It doesn't matter how strong the wind is. It doesn't matter who's climbing the tree or taking lumps off it or trying to bash it or walk its fruit. It doesn't matter. The tree will last because it's planted by the streams of water. It's got a deep root. It's healthy. And so it is with us, as we find our meaning and our purpose and our life in the Spirit, in God. So He causes us to grow, to put down those deep roots. Or we can grow this love and joy and peace and patience in a way that lasts and lasts and lasts, in a way that isn't dependent on the seasons changing, coming and going. In a way that lasts and lasts and lasts. This is the type of blessing that we'll live on. This is a forever change as God brings about his kingdom in us and through us. This is a root of life that is about blessing, not perishing. So the psalmist gives us a choice. Oh, we go to the next slide. We've got a choice. We've got a choice to find our company. To think of the people and the moments that we engage with. To think of every conversation and every person. Is this a blessing to me? Is this nurturing the thing that God is doing in my life, or is this undoing it? Which direction is this taking me in, towards God or away from God? The psalmist says, have a presence of mind. Be mindful in every conversation. Think, should I be nurturing this, or should I be putting a little bit of distance in here? But to recognize that it's not all about out there, it's actually in here too. The psalmist asks us to be mindful of ourselves, to choose to meditate on Jesus, to choose to fix our eyes on him as the author and perfecter of our faith, to choose to value his words most of all, to choose to dwell in scripture, in prayer, in service of one another. And as we do, we will discover more and more of this blessing. And as we do, we'll be better and better equipped to walk with the Spirit, day by day, moment by moment, nurturing his presence in us, knowing more and more of God's blessing upon us and with us, as we are a blessing to those around us. Whatever we do in our life, wherever we go, whoever we are with, we can be a blessing. We seek to put God first, to follow the words of his kingdom and his righteousness, trusting him to do his work in us. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you are a blessing God. That of all the ways that you can treat us as your creation, you chose to bless. You chose to go first in kindness and love. We thank you that we benefit from the fruit of your character, even as you bless us, Lord. God, I pray for this fellowship here, for each of us, that, Lord, we would know more and more of your blessing. We would know more of the peace and the contentment and the kindness and the patience and goodness that you have for us. And Lord, you would equip us to take that good fruit